Hi everyone, my name is Patrick Tanzariti. I'm a web developer from Sydney. Today I'm going to show you Charles, which is a web debugging proxy application. I'm going to show you what it can do, how I use it in my day-to-day work, and hopefully a few tips and tricks, a few things that you might not know of if you have used Charles before. So let's get started. Charles is a web debugging proxy application. That's a set of words that sounds really complicated, but really it just means that it's a middleman between your computer and the internet. It can read all the calls happening between your computer and the internet and intercept and change them in real time, which can be very valuable for web developers who are looking to test while developing. If you don't already have Charles, you can go to charlesproxy.com and follow the download links to get a free trial. As you can see, they've got versions for various OSs, so whether you're a Windows person or a Mac person or a Linux person, they've got you covered. If you are looking to buy it though, just as a heads up on the price, it's $50 for a single user license. It does get cheaper the more users that you're buying licenses for, so if you've got a team, you can take advantage of that. Personally, I found $50 is quite worthwhile though, for the amount of stuff it can do. Once you've got Charles installed, you'll end up with a screen like this one when you first open it up. What we have here is a list of requests that Charles has seen while it's been running. I've been running Charles for a little while before starting the screencast, so we've got a bunch of requests that have happened during that time. As you can see, they're grouped by domain, and basically Charles just sits there and watches anything that's happening and lists it out nice and neatly like this. As neat as it is though, I'm not a huge fan of this view, because for me, the grouping by domain isn't the easiest way to work. I find that when I'm web developing, I'm looking for which calls are coming through at which times. I'm generally waiting to see if a call is coming through when I've clicked something, or I'm generally looking to see if a certain parameter has been passed. The view that I usually use, and the view that I've seen most web developers use with this tool, is the sequence view. A sequence view you can get to using the sequence tab up here. This view is quite useful, as it shows all calls in the order that they're coming in. So it's all in chronological order from when Charles picked up each request. And there's a lot happening here, as we did have it running from before. So to clear it, we press Command A or Control A for Windows users, and then I'll click Delete, like so, and then I'll delete that bit and delete that one as well. One of the reasons that the sequence view is quite good is that you can filter. So I can filter it and say I would only like to have Google Analytics stuff. But now that we've cleared all our calls, we can't see anything, but I have a hunch that there'll be a Google Analytics call appearing anytime now. There we go. Right on time, very good. Thank you, Google. So now if I filter by UTM, that means that from now on, everything that will appear here has to have UTM in it, which is quite likely going to just be Google Analytics stuff. One of the real world examples for this is if you're testing tracking on your site and you want to ensure it's coming through, you can see the Google Analytics calls coming in here, including all of the parameters and the values being passed through. It can be quite useful if you're wondering if Google Analytics calls are being passed through on your website. To be fair, for a lot of Google Analytics stuff, I would just see whether the image itself is loading, which at the moment it is, and that's generally enough. Google do have a very valuable real-time view within their Google Analytics suite, so often once you know the image is loaded, you can go into that real-time view just to see whether calls are coming through to Google Analytics correctly. You can go to a bit more detail by seeing the contents of these calls if you're using more advanced custom functionality in Google Analytics. Another feature, which is actually the feature I use most with Charles, is also a feature which not as many web developers know of. You can find it in your tools menu up here under Map Local. And what this mysterious functionality does is it intercepts any requests for a specific location on the web and instead will serve up local files for that request. As an example, I'm going to use the Mary Amber website, which I developed a little while ago, and that's here at this host, www.maryamber.com. It is a WordPress website, which means we do have themes to work with. So our themes are at wp-content/themes/maryamber2013. The star is important here, as it says that we want to intercept any file and folder inside this directory on this host. Basically, anytime we hit the combo between this host and this path, we instead map it to the local path, which is down here on my own computer. So we map it to this Mariamba 2013 theme folder on my local machine. What this means in practice is that if we go to mariamba.com and we'll go to the music page, as that's a bit simpler of a page to do some testing on. We can now change things on this live site, but just for us to see for testing purposes. So this is quite useful if you want to see whether a file you're about to push live is about to break anything, and especially good for times when you're working with a client or a company that have asked you to investigate into an issue or problem with their existing site, but you don't have enough access to a development or staging environment just yet, but you still want to get started. It's also good for just before you're about to push something live, if you want to do one final last minute sanity check. It's perfect for those times. I've got the CSS for the site here on my local computer. And what we'll do just to show you an example is, let's assume that the next big thing on the web is having your font at a gigantic, enormous size just because people are into really, really big fonts. And not only that, but sans serif fonts are just completely boring now. We all want the stylish Times New Roman and also its equivalents. We'll save this on my local computer. And then what happens is, once it's updated on my local computer, when I refresh my browser, any more requests to the site are redirected to my local machine. That local CSS file is showing us our new Times New Roman design with our giant fonts. Remember though, this is just locally. It's still being seen in the regular, lovely sans serif font way on the rest of the web. I'll show a real-world example of something I genuinely want to do. I'll just revert the craziness. So one of the things I'd love to do is remove the reset CSS that I'm importing in here, because I'm finding I'd rather do it all in my own CSS, keep things a bit neater. So a few key taps, I remove it from my CSS, and then I hit refresh in my browser. And with Charles, I can see what it's going to look like. So far, so good. And I can do a bit more cross-browser testing on this machine as well, so I can go into Internet Explorer and such and see what it'll look like. One of the other very valuable uses for Charles, especially for testing, is throttling, which is slowing down our internet connection. To get there, go to the proxy menu and choose throttling. And you can also choose exactly what we want it to do by going to throttle settings, the same place. You can slow down the speed of your computer's internet connection to a whole range of things. We'll try the 56k modem for a bit of fun, which means we can test how websites will work on 56k modems. So let's go to a rather popular website and we'll see exactly how it runs. So we'll load Google, and as you can see, we've got a bit of a wait now, but soon enough, hopefully, it appears. There we go. So Google does load. It's a bit slow, but overall not too bad for a 56k modem. If you're working on websites targeted to the Western world, a lot of the time 56k modem speeds aren't really the benchmark. So you can choose more reasonable speeds like DSL, or even add your own custom presets, which you can do by changing these numbers and clicking add preset. I believe the 3G connection was a setting I made while I was doing a bit of responsive website testing. If you haven't used Charles before, or if you haven't even come across it before, I hope that this video has given you a bit of an urge to give it a go and try it in your web dev workflow. You might be surprised at just how useful you find this tool to be. I personally have absolutely loved it. If you have any questions about Charles or how I use it in my day-to-day work, you can find me on Twitter at thatpatrickguy. Or find my contact details on my website at patcat.me. Thanks for watching.